Hallelujah, Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Hallelujah, Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Hallelujah. Grace and peace to you in the name of our risen Lord Jesus the Christ. Good morning and welcome to this service of worship at Duke University Chapel. Whether you are here for your first time today, whether you're worshiping with us online, or you come every Sunday, we are so delighted to worship with you this morning. We pray that on this Resurrection Sunday, you would encounter our risen Lord anew. Rooted in the love of God in Jesus Christ, we at the chapel strive to respond to God's all-inclusive love at Duke, in Durham, and in the world. If you want to connect more deeply to the life of faith at the chapel, we invite you to scan the QR code that's on the back of your worship guide and fill out the short survey there. We would love to get to know you more. In your worship guide, you'll see opportunities to worship and to engage in the life of the chapel. We hope that you'll take this home with you so that you can remember the things that you read today. One opportunity that you'll have is today at 4 p.m. when we will have our Easter Choral Evensong service, and we hope that you'll consider attending that service. Because Christ is risen, we too have the hope of resurrected life. So as resurrection people, I invite you to rise as you are able in body and or spirit to worship our risen King.
Friends, confession is not the end of our worship, but the beginning, because here's where we discover the work of redemption that Christ has been doing since before the dawn of time. So let us pray together and find the grace that God is offering to us today. O Christ, in your resurrection, the heavens and the earth rejoice. Alleluia. By your resurrection, you broke open the gates of hell and destroyed sin and death. Forgive us, free us, and make us victorious over sin. By your resurrection, you raised the dead and brought us from death to life. Guide us in the way of eternal life. By your resurrection, you confounded your guards and executioners and filled the disciples with joy. Give us joy to serve you faithfully. By your resurrection, you proclaimed good news to the women and apostles and brought salvation to the whole world. Direct our lives as your new creation. Increase in our minds and hearts the risen life we share with Christ and help us to grow as your people toward the fullness of eternal life with you. Amen. Friends, before we knew our own name, Jesus came to us as friend and teacher and savior and risen Lord. He poured out his life and called us by name, and our sin will not have the final word. Once we were no people, now we are God's people. Hear and believe this good news. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Amen. As forgiven and peace-gifted people, it is our call to share Christ's peace with all whom we meet near and far. So I invite you now to pass the peace to your neighbor with a word or gesture. The peace of the risen Christ be with you.
Please join me in the prayer for illumination printed in your worship guide. Holy God, creator of all, this is the morning on which the Lord opened our eyes to what the scriptures foretold, that first he must die and then he would rise and ascend into his Father's glorious presence. May the risen Lord open our minds that we may know him and follow him in his risen life. Amen. A reading from Isaiah. On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will make for all peoples a feast of rich food, a feast of well-aged wines, of rich food filled with marrow, of well-aged wine strained clear. And he will destroy on this mountain the shroud that is cast over all peoples, the sheet that is spread over all nations. He will swallow up death forever. Then the Lord God will wipe away the tears from all faces, and the disgrace of his people will take away from all the earth, for the Lord has spoken. It will be said on that day, "Lo, this is our God. We have waited for him so that he might save us. This is the Lord for whom we have waited. Let us be glad and rejoice in his salvation." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you. A reading from 1 Corinthians. Now I would remind you, brothers and sisters, of the good news that I proclaimed to you, which you in turn received, in which you also stand, through which also you are being saved, if you hold firmly to the message that I proclaimed to you, unless you have come to believe in vain. For I handed on to you as of first importance what I in turn had received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas, then to the 12. Then he appeared to more than 500 brothers and sisters at one time, most of whom are still alive, though some have died. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles. Last of all, as to one untimely born, he appeared also to me. For I am the least of the apostles, unfit to be called an apostle because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace toward me has not been in vain. On the contrary, I worked harder than any of them, though it was not I, but the grace of God that is within me. Whether then it was I or they, so we proclaim, and so you have come to believe. The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
The Holy Gospel according to Mark. When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene and Mary the mother of James and Salome brought spices that they might go and anoint Jesus' body. And very early, on the first day of the week, when the sun had risen, they went to the tomb. They had been saying to one another, "Who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance to the tomb?" When they looked up, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had already been rolled back. As they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe, sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. But he said to them, "Do not be alarmed. You are looking for Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has been raised. He is not here. Look, there is the place they laid him. But go, tell his disciples and Peter that he is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you." So they went out and fled from the tomb, for terror and amazement had seized them, and they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. The word of the Lord.
Let us pray. Risen Christ, walk among us and speak your word now and forever. Amen. Please be seated. When you see the sermon title, Stoned, you might think of Woodstock, the music festival that began on August 15th, 1969, where They say 500,000 people converged on a dairy farm in Bethel, New York, for a three-day music festival. Where was I in 1969? I guess in God's mind. I've heard about this festival and seen images of it as well. Some of you might have been there. You don't have to raise your hands. It's not confession time. It was billed as an Aquarian experience, 3 days of peace and music. You get a glimpse of the Woodstock bygone days when we pass the peace here in our services. Some shake hands, others give the peace sign. Overall, they say Woodstock was a success. It was known for a lot of rock and roll, a lot of rain, a lot of drugs and sex. And even with all of those attendees, they say it was still a peaceful celebration. The Woodstock audience was diverse and a reflection of those changing times. In 1969, this nation was deep into the Vietnam War and the civil rights movement, so there were lots of protests and much unrest. Woodstock was seen as an opportunity for people to escape into music and spread a message of unity and peace. The vibe, they say, was harmonious. The hippies were out in full effect, living their mantra, make love, not war. And to be honest, some people attribute the lack of violence at that festival to the large number of psychedelic drugs that were being used. In other words, many at Woodstock were stoned, therefore hallucinating. But let me be clear that we aren't hallucinating today when I say Duke is in the Elite Eight and UNC is at home taking naps. It's truly a great Easter, y'all. But the mood, compared to Woodstock or a Duke win over Houston, is quite different for Mary Magdalene, Mary, the mother of James, and Salome when they bought spices to go and anoint the body of Jesus in the tomb. What they reveal is that you don't need psychedelic drugs in order to be stoned. They have lost their bearings since Jesus has died. Their mood, their hearts, their souls have been altered, and they aren't sure what's happening in their world. The ground has shifted underneath them, and they face an existential problem and raise questions and concerns. Who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance to the tomb? They are stoned on their path because a literal stone is in the way of their purpose. This stone blocks their plans and access to someone they love. Although they weren't the ones entombed, they feel trapped because they're not sure what to do. They're stoned. There are stones that imprison us and prevent us from working freely in the world and moving forward or getting closure. Stones can get in the way of our calling, our plans, our future. I can guarantee that these three women are stoned by heart-gnawing grief, not by some drug. And we all have some stones in our lives that need to be rolled away. But the truth is, there are some large stones in life that are just way too big, too heavy, too much for us to move by ourselves. No matter how hard we try, no matter how hard we push, no matter how hard we pray, there are some stones that we can't roll away in our own strength or ingenuity. The women are not the ones in the tomb, yet they feel buried by a stone, and they ask their burning question, who will roll away the stone for us? They show up at the tomb as if hallucinating, and they saw that the stone, which was very large, had already been rolled back. There's no brass, there's no steel drums, there's no Jimi Hendrix, no Carlos Santana, no Grateful Dead, no Easter Bunny flashing the peace sign with chocolate eggs. Just a young man inside the tomb who signals that he knows how it was removed. He tells them, don't be alarmed. You're looking for Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has been raised. He's not here. The young man, with all of his meaningful symbolism in the text, reveals that God raised Jesus from the dead, and it is God who rolled the stone away. This stone is gone due to divine intervention. The resurrection, Easter, reminds us that there are some things, like raising the dead, only God can do. Only God can move large stones that block our future and potential. Only God can give us a future. Not Warren Buffett, not Elon Musk, not even Beyonce with her new cool country album. Only God. That should be the Easter morning Duke University headline news on Duke Today. Only God. We might sing with the German Euro dance group Snap, if you remember, I've got the power. But don't get it twisted. The good news of Easter is that God has the wonder working power to roll stones away, not us. And it's a power that's bolstered by God's love for us, a love that is stronger than death. As Lutheran pastor Nadia Boltz-Weber wrote to encourage clergy about Easter, she says, our yearly reminder is that Jesus will rise from the dead, even if you forgot to print out the right hymns, even if the lilies arrive already wilted, even if the whole choir gets food poisoning, nothing will keep the stone from rolling away. You are loved. God's love for us rolls back the stone. We might think because we pass kidney stones that we can roll tombstones, but only God can do the latter. And notice that when they arrive at the tomb, the stone had already been rolled back. Without human initiative or power, God may answer your question or meet your need before you ever realize it, because God works ahead of you. This is why the stone was already rolled back before they even got there. God is always working and is often ahead of our own consciousness and desires. We worry and fret about things when God has already taken care of it. The stone is already rolled back. So please don't get ulcers for nothing. Who will roll the stone away for us? God will. This isn't March Madness. Easter is God's gladness. God moving even without our asking. Say that again, Powery. God moving even without our asking. Not only was the stone rolled back by God before the women arrived, notice that there is no direct prayer request or petition to God. They don't ask God directly to roll the stone away. They don't even talk to God and offer a long-winded prayer. They talk to each other, and they ask their burning question. They don't ask God to do it and treat him like a casino slot machine. I put this request in, and now, God, you put the answer out. They raised questions and concerns among themselves. But it's as if God heard their cry indirectly and answered it without them asking him for it. God moves the stone without them trying to push it themselves. God hears your heart's murmurings and questions to each other and knows what you need before you even ask directly. So God is always at work, always listening, whether we voice our concern or not. Some battles you don't and won't have to fight. Some stones are removed without our doing or asking. So don't keep trying to remove stones in your own strength when the resurrection shows us that all power is in God's hands, not our own. Chinese church leader and teacher Watchman Nee put it this way, God is waiting till you cease to do. So when you cease doing, God can do. It's significant that the stone is rolled away without the women asking God to do it, because it reminds us that the resurrection is not about what we can do with all of our words and our pleas and our degrees and our certificates, our expertise, our human agency. No, the resurrection is about divine agency and what God can do and what God has done and what God will do. God rolled the stone away and raised Jesus. Only God. And may I be so bold to say that God knows we all need a resurrection. We all need to be Eastered up in some area of our life. God knows you need a brighter future than your past. And because our future is tied up in Christ, know that you too will be raised. You may be stoned in your own way right now, but if a stone is involved, watch God work. When David was to battle Goliath the Philistine, it took one smooth stone with a sling to defeat that giant. When Joshua wanted to encourage the children of Israel and remind them of God's powerful hand, he took 12 stones out of the Jordan to remind them that Israel passed over the Jordan on dry ground, just as God did for them in the Red Sea when they came out of Egypt. And think about what God says in Ezekiel. I'm going to remove the heart of stone from you and give you a new heart, a heart of flesh. And all throughout the Psalms and the New Testament, we hear the stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. A stone in God's hands will lead to salvation, victory, and new life, just like we see at Easter. So when you look at this stone building, look around that we call Duke Chapel. Celebrate the cornerstone. Celebrate the rolling stone. Celebrate the hope of the resurrection. The building is cruciform, which reminds us of the suffering Jesus endured on the cross. But the stone structure itself should remind us that the stone has been rolled back and Jesus has been raised. So we are surrounded by resurrection hope this morning, the great cloud of stones. In the face of the empty tomb, the women were afraid. You can't blame them. As biblical scholar Ched Myers writes, for Mark, the Gospel of Mark, resurrection is not an answer but the final question. So how will I follow? Will you let go and stop trying to move stones by yourself and let God roll away the stone? A man named Jack was walking along a steep cliff one day when he accidentally got too close to the edge and he fell. And on the way down, he grabbed a hold of a branch, which temporarily stopped his fall. He looked down in horror and saw that the canyon fell straight down for more than 1,000 feet. He couldn't hang on to the branch forever, as you can imagine, and there was no way for him to climb up the steep wall of the cliff. And so Jack began yelling for help, hoping that someone passing by would hear him. Help! Help! Is anyone up there? He yelled for a long time, but no one seemed to hear him, and he was about to give up when he heard a voice. Jack? Jack, can you hear me? Yes, yes, I can hear you. I'm down here. I can see you, Jack. Are you all right? Yes, but who are you and where are you? I am the Lord, Jack. I'm everywhere. The Lord? You mean God? That's me. God, please help me. I promise if you'll get me down from here, I'll stop sinning. I'll be a really good person. I'll serve you for the rest of my life. Easy on the promises, Jack. Let's get you off from there, and then we can talk. Now, here's what I want you to do. Listen carefully. I'll do anything, Lord. Just tell me what to do. Okay. Let go of the branch. What? I said, let go of the branch. Just trust me. Let go. There was a very long silence. And finally, Jack yelled, help, help, is anyone else up there? It's hard for us to let go because we think we can fix everything. But some things only an Easter God can do. Let go so the burdens of your heart can roll away like a stone. Let go for the tomb is already empty, but your future is not. The empty tomb is a womb for a full future in God. Let go and let God. You can't survive on your own. Let go of whatever you're holding on to so tightly and just rest in the arms of the crucified, risen one, Jesus Christ, and find real peace. Don't be afraid, because in the risen Christ, this peace is also a victory.
Thank you.
Friends, we do not walk the way of faith alone, so let us affirm our faith together and pray and recite together the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. We prepare now to pray for this world which our Lord Jesus has loved so well. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Glorious triune God, on this holy, joyful day of resurrection, you cradle all creation in redeeming love. By the power of the Holy Spirit, we declare that death's grip has been shattered and the world's cruelty and judgment have been broken into pieces. We offer our prayers through Christ, who wipes away every tear, who is risen from the dead, who lives and reigns forever, who prays for this world which he loved through death and into a glorious resurrection hope beyond the grave. Bend low and heed the prayers of our hearts, both the ones we name out loud and those we hold in silence. Living Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Creator God, we pray for the Church Universal. Teach us how to be people of joy, living witnesses to the power of the resurrection, testifying to the stones that only God can roll away. We pray for all of creation. From the dust of the ecologically damaged earth, raise up healing and new life, stewarded and cared for by us, your creatures, and all your faithful servants. Living Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Incarnate God, we pray for all nations. Let your message of good news spread throughout the world, declaring that within the reign of God, cruelty and sin and death have dominion no more. May all around the world who cower from violence or flee their collapsing homes find the care and refuge that they need. May all who steadfastly seek to make a path of peace find protection in the shadow of your wings. May your way of justice and hope become the foundation for all people. This week, we particularly pray for those in Gaza and Ukraine, those affected by bombing in Azaz, Syria, and cyclones and floods in Madagascar. We pray for all those who are hidden from the headlines of our news feed, whom you know by name. Living Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Comforting God, we pray for our neighbors and loved ones. Give comfort to those who are bent over with tears. Grant rest to those whose backs are aching with work. Anoint patience upon those who wait for good news. Shower peace upon those who are awake in the night with worry. Light the path for those who wonder where their next step of faith might lead. Turn mourning into dancing and sorrow into joy and isolation into the delight of companionship and community. Living Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of all power and glory, receive these prayers. Roll away every imprisoning boulder of our fears and teach us to celebrate the cornerstone that was rejected before and is made now into the foundations of our very lives. Reveal to us your glory in this radiant day and raise us to new life in Christ, empowering us to serve you so that your words may be in our mouths, your strength in our arms, your love in our hearts, even as we seek the dawning of faith anew each day. All this we pray in the name of Jesus Christ, the one who calls to us and cherishes us, the one who reaches out his hands to us and welcomes us into his great redemption story, transforming our lives by the tender power of the Holy Spirit today, tomorrow, and forever. Amen. Friends, we now invite you to fill out the attendance pads that are located at the end of your pews. Fill them out, and if you run out of space, you can turn to another page, pass these along, and let us know that you are here. Like the disciples of the early church, in the spirit of the first believers, we are called to share our goods in common and contribute to the needs of those among us with glad and generous hearts. So let us offer today our time, our talents, and our very tithes and lives to the risen Lord. Let us give joyfully and generously.
Lord God, you make our hearts leap with alleluias in a resurrection song. We praise you for your abundant mercy, your bountiful grace, and your endless love. Most of all, we praise you for the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. In his death and resurrection, he overcomes death, dismantles sin, and reunites us with you forever. Because of your Son, our eyes and hearts may overflow with fountains of joy. Fill us with the imagination of your kingdom, that we might be caught in wonder of the mercy, grace, kindness, and joy of everlasting life with you. We offer this prayer in the name of our risen Savior Jesus, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Receive now this blessing. Let go and find peace. The tomb is empty, and Christ is risen. And may the blessings of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be upon you now and always. Amen.
Thank you. you.